Exploding by Chris Chibnall. She was cold. The doctor was cold. The raggedy clothes weren't helping. She was cold and in someone else's ragged clothes. She felt a little peeved that the ragged clothes did not include an inbuilt parachute. That felt like a bit of an error.
Wait,
she thought.
Why would I want a parachute? Oh, yeah, that's right,
she remembered. She was falling. The air was rushing past her. More accurately, she was rushing past air, tumbling through the cold night sky. Also, she was fizzing. Remnants of regeneration particles were still skittering off her. The process was still in process, her newness still in train. The doctor looked up mid-plummet. Oh dear, she thought. Far above her, the TARDIS was exploding.
That's very unhelpful, she thought. No, wait, not just exploding.
Now the TARDIS was dematerialising. Well, it exploded.
Dematerialised exploding, the doctor thought. That's not a word,
chimed in the doctor.
All right, replied the doctor. I'm only a few minutes in here. You're lucky I can have any words at all. Will you two stop arguing?
Chimed in the doctor.
Only if you stop subdividing us,
replied the doctor.
This is all the same brain. Don't confuse matters.
As the blue box vanished, leaving the doctor looking up at a starry black sky, the doctor wondered if she'd ever see the TARDIS again.
No time to feel sorry for yourself, she told herself. Too much going on. Yeah, she thought. There's a lot going on.
A large, dark, painful ground mass was rapidly approaching. And inside the doctor's body, her cells continued burning and reshaping and reforming.
Well,
thought the doctor, all of her.
This is a conundrum.
Her newly minted mind had already had 3,070 thoughts over the course of 3 seconds. She knew because she counted. And she only realised she'd counted once she'd finished counting. And then she wondered whether the counting made 3,080 thoughts. And then she realised that the ground was another second closer and a plan would probably be in order. She saw the ground and calculated her own velocity.
Oh, this is gonna hurt,
she thought. Even with a soft landing, and it probably wouldn't be a soft landing. She crossed her fingers and hoped she was heading for an open-air trampoline factory.
Huh, like that planet. What's it called? Fintelbaroxtug. Fun fact about Fintelbaroxtug, she told herself. The creature that named it did so when it hiccuped just before it was sick. Nobody knows if that's his actual name or whether it's just the sound it made. You don't have to tell me that,
thought the doctor, tetchily to herself.
I know the planetary surface of Fintelbaroxtug is as soft and bouncy as a trampoline, because I went on a long bounce there once among the mountains in the purple sky. I just had an ice cream sundae. That was a mistake. Oh, can you please concentrate?
The doctor thought to herself. She concentrated and confirmed she was still falling.
Disappointing.
But not that much of a surprise given her circumstances hadn't changed in the seconds since she last checked. She wondered exactly where she was. Which sky was she falling from? Which ground was she heading for? She stuck her tongue out. It was buffeted by the air. Tickled.
Ah, that tastes like Earth. North Europe. Britain? Wood smoke. Diesels, grass. Fast approaching concrete. Lots of moisture and attitude in the air. Yorkshire? Probably South Yorkshire.
She snuck another look down. A train track. A stationary train. She tried to recognise the livery on the side of the train so she could absolutely nail precisely where she was. But it was distant and dark, and regeneration had once again failed to deliver her the superpower to see in the dark X-ray vision she had always craved.
Ah well, she thought. Maybe next time.
Now the train below was insisting on getting closer. The train or the track? Where was she going to land? She pondered her limited choices. Tracks would hurt. Mouthful of gravel and two big metal lines all the way up her new body.
Ouch. Train might be better.
The roof! If she could crash through it, would soften the landing a bit. Though smashing through it was likely going to hurt a lot. With a bit of luck, any injuries would be taken care of by the still fizzing regeneration process. Like those injuries the doctor had after she crashed through the roof of Nasmyth Manor, or the hand she'd managed to grow back after the Sycorax had lopped it off. That roof was super close now. She flapped her arms a bit to make sure her trajectory was bang on. As she did so, she saw that the train lights were out. She saw sparks of light flashing in one of the carriages towards the back of the train. Something was wrong. And if something was wrong, she was the man to sort it out.
You're assuming you're going to make it through this fall alive, she reminded herself. Now, don't be gloomy,
she tinted back.
Things will be all right. Right now, they're not ideal, but I can muddle through. Probably. That's interesting,
she thought.
I seem to be a bit of an optimist, with a hint of enthusiasm. And what's that warm feeling in my stomach? Ha! I'm kind! Brilliant. This is going to be fun,
thought the doctor, as she crashed through the roof of the train on the outskirts of Sheffield, not far from Grindleford. Then, having hit the floor of the train and felt extra regenerative energy particles heal where things had scratched and broken and hurt,
newness in a train. On a train,
she thought to herself.
This is going to be a very interesting night.
The doctor jumped up, zapped a creature she couldn't quite understand, and immediately made a new friend.